The holidays make me depressed. Here I am, with an above-average awareness of the impending, or rather already unfolding, apocalypse. I'm shell-shocked from the sheer volume of climate catastrophe news this year. I get a pit in my stomach over the thought of us entering another year, us inching ever closer to the make-or-break year of 2030, and holy smokes, do you realize we're as close in time to 2030 as we are to 2014? No, that can't be. 2014 was 2 years ago, wasn't it? Are we on track to cut carbon emissions in half by 2030? Is 1.5 still alive? Well, emissions dipped in 2020, I'm sure you know why, but we're almost back at pre-pandemic levels already. So I have all of this on my mind, I'm anxious about the future, and you, by you I mean the Western world basically, you are telling me that some costumes and decorations and lights are gonna make me go, "'Tis a season to be jolly, fa-la-la-la-la, ha-ha-ha-ha." Wait, what's this? I like Christmas, or Yuletide, as I've decided to call it from now on, because it's simply a more fun word to say than Christmas. Sure, it can be obnoxious, stressful, undoubtedly kitschy, but I enjoy the lights and decorations, and even some of the music, in moderation. And of course, I enjoy spending time with the family. I find I look more forward to Yuletide during years that for whatever reason have been difficult for me. I find comfort in Yuletide, but also, sometimes, I find depression. And it feels jarring because you're supposed to be happy during Yuletide, and so you get depressed over the fact that you're depressed. Meta-depression. As late as last year, I was gripped by a profound and quite complex kind of sadness while watching specials on TV, specifically a clip from an old Disney movie. I felt nostalgic, but it wasn't good nostalgia, because I couldn't help but think about the end of the world. Yes, even on Yuletide Eve, I think about the eco-crisis. I couldn't help but think about the future, even on the occasion when time is supposed to, you know, slow down and freeze, you know what I mean? Isn't the success of a Yuletide celebration measured in part by how similar it is to all the ones that have come before? Like, the same food, same music, same decorations, same movies, same people? Isn't it about trying to recapture a hint of the childhood wonder you felt during Yuletides of yore, or experiencing it vicariously through your own children, grandchildren, nieces or nephews or what have you? The holidays are supposed to be a time bubble of sorts. But time doesn't slow down or stop. It never goes back. It goes forward, whether we like it or not. Anyway, while contemplating the end of the world and my feeling of powerlessness in the face of it, nostalgia felt perverse. Although nostalgia always feels a touch perverse to me now. I'm far from the first to observe that we live in nostalgic times. I mean, virtually all the popular movies these days are either adaptations, sequels, prequels, remakes, reboots, etc. Ditto for video games, which also revolve around remasters, reimaginings, retro aesthetics, etc. The 80s have been back in vogue for about 20 years now, and now the 90s are back too. I'm also by no means the first to problematize this nostalgia, to wonder what it says about our age that we are constantly looking back, that we have stopped trying to imagine the future. Mark Fisher said it's a symptom of
knucking feo-liberalism.
The future has been cancelled. When we do imagine it, it's bleak as hell. And when the present is unbearable too, all you could do is look back. There's something tragically feeble in escaping into nostalgia, into a lost, idealized childhood while the world burns. It's a distraction I find bordering on irresponsible. That's what I mean by nostalgia feeling perverse. I don't judge anyone for their nostalgia, mind you. Like, thinking too much about the enormity of the world's problems drives you crazy, so why not indulge in a little nostalgia? But I couldn't do it last Yuletide Eve. It wasn't merely feeling perverse nostalgia that upset me, it had just as much to do with what made me nostalgic, namely Disney. I simply can't enjoy Disney the way I did as a child. Not only because the movies in hindsight turn out to have some problematic content, but more because... Jiminy Cricket, they're gonna own everything, aren't they? The goofiest yet plausible dystopia I can think of is one where Disney buys up Facebook, sorry, I mean Meta, so they can capture the VR market, and eventually, while the rest of the world starves in a wasteland, the privileged few will escape into a virtual Disney world. This is how the world ends. Not with a bang, nor a whimper, but a yuck. And still, I'm going to contribute to this future happening by forking over my hard-earned money to get Disney Plus so I can watch Get Back. Disney had all the money they could dream of, but they knew it wouldn't last. So they bought up Star Wars, Marvel, and the Muppets, and anything that made some cash. Break up, break up, break up the wealth concentration. Break up, break up, break up the wealth concentration. Here's a meme that captures much of my feelings around this. I'm amazed by how specific it is. Who needs therapy when you have relatable memes? Warning, memes are not a proper substitute for therapy. But enough about Disney and nostalgia. Another reason I dislike Yuletide is... well, this is something of a cliche, but here it goes. The holidays have gotten so... commercialized, man. It's gotten so... materialistic, like people just run around and shop all the time, thinking that'll make them and their loved ones happy, and it's just sad. People have forgotten what the holidays are supposed to be about. Cliched, maybe, but I think it's true. The probably most famous articulation of this critique is How the Grinch Stole Christmas. I mean, Yuletide, I mean, let's make an exception here. This just goes to show how old this critique is. The picture book came out in the 1950s, while the TV special was made in the 60s. In case you don't know the story, the titular Grinch, who hates Christmas, tries to steal it. Hence the title. The titular character does the thing in the title. He tries to steal Christmas by snatching all the gifts and decorations from the people of Whoville. Spoiler alert, he fails. Or, he succeeds in stealing all the gifts and decorations, but not in stealing Christmas. The townsfolk come out of their houses, hold hands, and sing carols together. Because it turns out, Christmas isn't really about gifts and decorations. Maybe Christmas, he thought, doesn't come from a store. Maybe Christmas, perhaps, means a little bit more. Heartwarming message, but liberal critique. It ignores the reason behind consumption. Everybody says we consume too much, but nobody asks, why do we consume?
I'll tell you why. It's because of... Sapatalism. That's how you pronounce it, right?
Without consumption, or even just reduced consumption, profits plummet, the market pisses pants, and sapatalism breaks down. The holiday season is great for encouraging excessive consumption, which is why it's a boon and arguably vital to sapatalism. All this, of course, has a terrible ecological impact, a point they make to some degree in the Jim Carrey movie.
But even with the anti-consumerist, implicitly anti-sapatalist, and vaguely environmentalist message of The Grinch and Grinch, two of the three highest-grossing Yuletide movies ever, you can see that these movies were used to sell toys, cereals, pistachios, pancakes, which look absolutely disgusting, by the way. Why make pancakes green? Why? Hondas, Sprite, kids' meals, online shopping sites, and Visa cards? Really? I guess the real meaning of Christmas is credit card debt? So the story of the Grinch is critical of consumerism, yet used to prop up consumerism. That's a typical Hollywood move, also seen in the likes of WALL-E. Yeah, those WALL-E toys will probably end up in a landfill, but don't worry, the real WALL-E will clean them up in 1,000 years or so. The holidays reveal some of the worst aspects of Zapatilism.
Relentless advertising, conspicuous consumption, stress induced by the pressure to buy stuff made from resources and minerals ripped out of the bowels of the earth by exploited labor, in turn manufactured in slave factories running on coal, and then shipped around the world on boats fueled by oil plundered in imperialist wars, generating mountains of waste every step of the way. Also, we can buy each other gifts that we probably don't need, ostensibly to show your loved ones that you do indeed love them.
Merry Yuletide, my child. We bought you an expensive present to show how much we love you. Hopefully, you'll overlook how emotionally distant we are the rest of the year.
Because tradition. Because the economy.
Now, I don't want to suggest that gift-giving is inherently bad. Thoughtful, heartfelt, and useful gifts can be a beautiful way to show affection. It's when gift-giving gets co-opted by consumerism and survivalism that it gets messed up. Because of all the expectations consumerism imposes on people, the holidays might just be the worst time of year to be poor. Every year I see stories in the news about people asking for financial help, often anonymously due to shame, so that they can afford a decent holiday celebration for themselves and their families. It's heartbreaking, and of course there are more people struggling these days. So, not only is consumerism ecologically destructive, it's societally destructive, it's exclusionary, it divides people between those able to conspicuously consume and those not. Outrageous class differences. Yet another way in which the world being terrible gets in the way of holiday cheer and instead brings on depression. It doesn't have to be like this though. Even if Yuletide is the time of year when everything's supposed to be the same, when time is supposed to stop, it could also be a time of reflection, of looking back as well as ahead, and note the changes. The holidays could act as a reminder that we can change the world for the better. I mean, here we are at the darkest, coldest, and potentially most gloomy time of year, at least on the northern hemisphere, yet long ago we decided to fill it with lights, warmth, and cheer. Almost as if out of spite, as if to defy our circumstances. Making the world a better place happens like that too, in defiance of the world itself. It's not easy, it often demands significant personal sacrifice, but it's in everyone's power to make the world better, because we aren't alone, because you matter, because we all matter, because we are social communal beings, because we exist to help each other, we exist to make life wonderful for each other. It's a Wonderful Life is the best Yuletide film ever, and if you disagree, then I'm sorry, you're objectively wrong, please change your opinion. I'm obviously kidding, but only a little. George Bailey is on the brink of suicide on Yuletide Eve. Although it's not so much that he wants to die, he just wishes he was never born. Anyone out there relate to that? Anybody? Thanks to his guardian angel, his wish comes true, and he gets to see what the world would have been like if he'd never been born. Turns out, without his selfless efforts to stand up against the monopolist aspirations of this vitalist Mr. Potter, his hometown becomes a cold, cruel, and cynical place. George realizes he's far from being a failure. He's not worth more dead than alive. His positive impact on the world is far greater than he had ever imagined. As his guardian angel says, and excuse the gendered language, each man's life touches so many other lives. When he isn't around, he leaves an awful hole. George returns to the real world full of joy, and everyone he's helped out over the years help him out of the financial trouble he's gotten into, in a giant act of communal gift-giving. It's beautiful. It's the part that makes grown men cry, and that's okay and dope. The powerful and necessary message of the movie is simple. You matter. Not in a shallow, individualistic way, but in a more profound, communal one. Help those around you, and they'll help you in turn. You can change the world with other people. Not only is it possible to change the world, you may have done so already, in ways you don't yet realize.
It's easy to think that our actions don't matter, that we don't matter. But that's not true. You matter. We all matter. There's hope in every single one of us. Each person's life touches so many other lives. When they aren't around, they leave an awful hole. this isn't over yet. I've been gloomy in this video, like talking about the apocalypse and whatnot, but I don't want to suggest that it's too late. We haven't even seen the full impact of our work yet. The work of every single one who's tried to make the world a better place. Every single one who proves that the world is worth fighting for, and that life is indeed wonderful. I'm sorry if this is getting like sentimental or hokey or whatever at the end, but allow me some holiday sentimentality, some holiday kitsch. Happy Hollymas, everybody. Happy Yuletide. Hope you'll have a good one next year.
Thanks for watching. This video got a bit lacking in jokes at the end, so I'm sharing one here to make up for it. The FBI, J. Edgar Hoover himself, denounced It's a Wonderful Life as communist propaganda. In 1947, he sent out a memo stating, "With regard to the picture It's a Wonderful Life, Redacted stated in substance that the film represented rather obvious attempts to discredit bankers by casting Lionel Barrymore as a Scrooge type so that he would be the most hated man in the picture. This, according to these sources, is a common trick used by communists." In addition, Redacted stated that, in his opinion, this picture deliberately maligned the upper class, attempting to show that people who had money were mean and despicable characters. This is obviously ridiculous, although it's funny to note that the movie was out of copyright for a long time and in the public domain, thus owned by no one and everyone. Wait, maybe it is secretly communist? Oh no, that would be terrible.